Only 800 of 4,000 of plastic producing companies in the Philippines have committed to reduce their plastic footprint by 20%. Environment Undersecretary Jonas Leones says companies may still be waiting to see whether they should commit to having the government monitor their compliance with the Extended Producer Responsibility Act. Under the EPR Act, companies that fail to collect 20% of their plastic footprint may be slapped with fines ranging from 5 to 15 million pesos. Leones says the government wants at least 1,000 companies listed in the monitoring scheme by year end.
Tayo medyo nag-a-adjust pa. Siguro pag na-meet na natin yung talagang implementation na to, na ayos na, ito yung mga bago eh, mga birth pains natin na tinatawag. But I'm optimistic and I believe that once we implement this EPR law, tuloy-tuloy na to at lahat magko-comply na.
Breaking news this afternoon, the Philippine government and the National Democratic Front of the Philippines have agreed to resume peace talks in a bid to end the more than five decades old armed struggle. Both parties say they recognize the need for the nation to unite in the face of serious socioeconomic, environmental, and foreign security issues. In a statement released by the Presidential Communications Office, both sides agreed to engage in dialogues to address the socioeconomic and political drivers of the armed conflict. The National Democratic Front of the Philippines is the political wing of the Communist Party of the Philippines and the New People's Army. Foreign businessmen welcome the extension of the Philippines' GSP Plus trade perks with the European Union. Paolo Duarte of the European Chamber of Commerce hails it as an important milestone. He says this will help negotiations for a free trade agreement between Manila and the regional bloc. Duarte also sees agriculture and electronics as among the critical sectors benefiting from the four-year extension of the scheme.
This is a good opportunity for Filipino companies to export to Europe, but also to European companies to invest in the Philippines, because this will enable also the products that have been that are produced in the Philippines then to be exported to Europe. So we foresee that the range of 6,200 SKUs or products that are being currently exported under the GSP Plus to continue to grow.
The Philippine finance chief expects the country's economy to outgrow its East Asia and Pacific peers. Secretary Benjamin Diokno cited on Tuesday financial institutions that have predicted the Philippines will continue to grow in 2024 despite the projected slowdown of the world economy. Diokno sees economic growth of around 6% this year. He also anticipates growth of up to 8% for the rest of President Marcos's term.
If you take the first three quarters, Q1 to Q3, the Philippines is still the fastest growing. So the average growth rate from the first to second to the third quarter is 5.5, followed by Indonesia, or rather China, 5.2, Indonesia 5.1, and then so and so forth and so on. So as you can see, if you consider Asia as the fastest growing region in the world, we are the fastest growing economy in the fastest growing region in the world.
Diokno also bared Marcos may sign the government spending plan for next year by December. He said Marcos could enact into law the 5.7 trillion peso outlay before leaving for Tokyo for the Japan-ASEAN summit in mid-December. Diokno is also urging Marcos to certify as urgent several tax bills to help ensure financing of next year's budget and achieve the country's deficit to GDP target of 5.1% in 2024.
We asked the president to act on the following requests. These are some tax measures, VAT on digital services, excise tax on single-use plastics. This is for climate change proposal. Ito namang VAT on digital services. This is based on fairness.
Earlier today, the Senate approved the proposed national budget with a vote of 21-1 and one abstention. The Senate and House will next reconcile differences of the two versions of the bill. The Philippine government allows a civilian group to push through with its planned Christmas convoy in the West Philippine Sea, the Atin Ito Coalition said. They held a constructive dialogue with key officials of the National Task Force on the West Philippine Sea on their plan to spread Christmas cheer to troops as well as fisherfolk. But its co-convener, Edicio de la Torre, says they will only pass through the general vicinity of the Yungin Shoal as well as the other eight Philippine features within the West Philippine Sea.
So we sought dialogue, which was very, very fruitful and constructive last Friday, 1 hour and a half. And as they said, look, we can understand your initial focus, but could you consider, yes, okay, we have the authority to give you permission to travel into the Ayungan Shoal because that's within our jurisdiction.
Okay.
But don't force Sierra Madres like an end-all, be-all. Originally, we thought of December 5, 6 as a target date, but we might have to push it back a few days, maybe 9, 10.
Okay.
We'll finalize that either today or tomorrow.
The Philippine Coast Guard, for its part, told Teleradio Serbisyo, they advised the convoy against visiting a Yungin Shoal for their safety.
Even the Philippine Coast Guard and the Armed Forces of the Philippines, whenever we do the resupply, talagang mararamdaman mo yung aggressive behavior ng China sa pagkakandak ng resupply. So we are thinking na if we're going to allow civilian boats to do their Christmas convoy dito, baka mapalagay sa panganib ang mga kababayan natin, no? Despite of their good intention.
Mm-hmm.
Alam naman natin na ang People's Republic of China won't have that kind of humanitarian consideration. We can really anticipate na China Coast Guard will still be doing the same aggressive behavior that they are showing with the Philippine Coast Guard whenever we do the resupply. Oh.